We're constantly hearing alarming stories about how standards are slipping, blah, blah, blah. You could be forgiven for thinking the sky's falling in. Clearly, though, many of our state schools are getting great results. But there is a problem, and it's one that we've been having for decades. Our Māori and Pacifica kids from lower decile schools, are lagging at the tail end. So what does lower decile actually mean? There are many parents who believe that the lower the decile rating, the lower the quality of the school. But is that true? I've come to Point England Primary School in one of Auckland's poorest neighbourhoods for some answers.
Well, Fiss, how are you?
Good.
You look great. I like your hair. It's really cool. Hey, beautifuls. Look at you. Nice to see you this morning. Gonna have a happy day? Hey,
hello.
Peter. How are you?
Hello.
Hey, yeah. Hey, Justice. Hello. How are you? Good morning, man.
You are the principal of a decile 1A school. Can you explain what's a decile 1A school?
So deciles come from the census that we all participate in as New Zealanders. The household income is averaged out, and it creates a ranking 1 to 10 that have some letters associated with them, A, B, and C, so you can be 1A, 1B, 1C. We're 1A, which is the bottom. I guess 10Z would have to be the top then, wouldn't it?
How many years would your kids be behind, say, kids in a, I don't know, decile 10 school?
We'd say generically that when kids start school at age 5 here, they have an academic age of around 3. And typically that would be things like you mightn't know your colours, you mightn't know your alphabet, you may or may not know your last name, and you probably don't know your digits 1 to 9.
And if that wasn't a big enough challenge, before the teaching day even starts, Point England School provides needy kids with a free breakfast because there isn't enough food to go around at home.
So what's for breakfast this morning then?
This morning it's Weet-Bix and Milo's.
Nice. The staples. Do you like some more Milo? Little bit? Anybody else want to top up?
I mean, the really nice thing about this lot is that it is a little breakfast club, so they come and chat and they talk about Milo and they talk about Weet-Bix.
When you have your Weet-Bix, do you crush them up or do you have them whole with milk on top?
I have them whole.
I'm a crusher. You're a crusher? You're a whole?
Just crush.
You're a crusher?
I kind of have mixed feelings about this. It's great that there are programs where kids can come to school and have breakfast, but I worry about the reasons why we have to do this.
Like, some of these parents will be working long hours at low-paid jobs and they literally can't afford to give their kids breakfast. That just seems wrong.
The numbers are maybe not the big deal. The problem is it's constant. We feed between 10 and 25 every morning, and at lunch there'd be the same number again every day. And so we've got 630 kids here, and there's this constant number of children. And it's a recycling group. It's not always the same people. It's people who've had stuff happen in their lives. So if your average adult income is $19,000, you don't need much to go wrong in your life to not be able to afford a necessity of life.
Maths is hugely important when you're trying to make 19,000 feed a whole family. So how do we teach kids about numbers? The numeracy project, as it's called, uses a completely different method from the one that I was taught. Kids learn that there's more than one way of solving a maths problem, and they work in a small group rather than as a class.
What's the problem we're working on?
We are going to attempt to change one of these decimal numbers into a whole number.
Mm-hmm. So why do you teach in a small group as opposed to teach everybody all at once?
Well, I guess in a class of 32 students, in an ideal world, everyone would be at the same level, and they're not. So this is, small groups is a way of having the strategies taught that make sense for them wherever they are in their learning. So it's a very easy way, I suppose, to individualize learning.
So I thought I'd try and get to grips with this newfangled math stuff.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, absolutely.
Can you add or subtract to make it? So can I take?
It's entirely up to you.
Okay. Yep. 2.88 plus 2.64. Does that mean like I'm going 3 plus 2.64? No? But that means it's 2.88 plus 3. So I'm trying to work that out. No. How did I do that? Do you guys like maths?
Yes.
And are you just saying that because you're sitting here with your maths teacher? Yes. Why do you like maths?
The strategies.
What? And why does the strategies make it more enjoyable?
Because it'll be easier for when you go off to do other stuff.
But this is about having lots of different ways to get to the answer setting.
It's about understanding numbers and how they work. So, you did it one way. You're finished. Great. Can you do that another way for me?
If you had to sit down and you just got like a maths book and they gave you a pencil and you'd have to sit there for an hour and add and subtract, would that be boring or would that be fun and exciting and interesting?
Boring. Boring.
Yeah. I certainly understand the tension between people of my generation and this stuff, because at first glance, it seems looser. But when you see kids applying it, it really makes sense. What you need in life is a whole bunch of strategies. If you come across a problem and you've only got one way to solve it and it doesn't work, you're stuffed. It makes learning fun, and it makes maths not such a big brick wall. Like, it's this sort of interesting little jungle, and there's a whole bunch of different ways through it. Point England School is determined not to be defined by its low decile rating. It's developed an e-learning network of 11 local schools, the sort of thing I'd only expect to see at wealthier schools. It's pretty amazing.
We have a new kind of partnership operating that's probably hasn't happened in New Zealand quite like this before. We're provisioning kids with the capacity to acquire their own netbook devices and get connections to people's houses.
How do you, in one of the communities with the lowest average income in the country, how on earth do you do that?
The cool thing is, the parents want it to happen. And interestingly, out of a program of development that's costing $4.5 million over 3 years, our parents are contributing, out of the lowest incomes in the country, Nigel, they're contributing $1.2 million. So one third of that total is actually being paid at $3.50 a week by parents.
Wow. It's the scale of the ambition that staggers me. The school has teamed up with the government, telcos and parents, and are linking the whole community with Wi-Fi so the kids can stay engaged and still learning at home.
So that what they get at home is identical to what's at school. It's a learning network.
Raina Garcia is one of those kids plugged into the network. Technology is a big part of the school.
I think it's awesome because we're in a technological era and the kids get to advance in their learning. And because I go to a lot of the homeschool partnership meetings, and what we saw is that they're bridging the gap from the written work. And yes, there were concerns that the children's writing would not be neat, but that's something that can be worked on over time. But it gives kids the opportunity to advance, not only locally, nationally, but also internationally.
Well, so what do you want to be? Like, what's your plan?
I've always thought of being a police officer and being, like, a person who helps out in the community and stuff.
For a lot of families here, life, I'd imagine, should be a bit of a struggle sometimes.
Yeah, it's a bit of a struggle. But families get by, you know. I think it's because we all have each other's back. I mean, there's all the stuff you hear, oh, it's GI, it's Glenanus, nothing good can come from that community. But it's like, stop labelling us, you know, stop putting labels on us and come in and have a look at what is done. Because our community is really tight.
It's a really good point. We often make assumptions about who's capable of achieving what based on the average income of a community. This school has shown me that it doesn't. I've taken myself back to school to try and understand how much the system has changed from my day and whether it works. I'm back at the Point England Primary School.
So this lesson that we're doing now, what's this lesson?
It's writing. We're reading a text and we're just answering questions.
Okay.
A lot of parents get anxious that things like computer gadgets and group work come at the expense of real learning.
Do you understand why parents get a bit anxious when they look at this? They go, well, how's this learning? They're not all reciting things out loud.
Well, as a parent, I would look, first of all, is my kid happy and motivated? And then you could look at things like their achievement and what they're able to, what levels they're at.
How are we going to find out? What months are the autumn months?
Google.
Ah, we turn to Google. Autumn, from March to May. Okay, March to May. March to May it is.
We do teach being cyber smart, but there's far more learning, I would say, in here than what we had before we had digital devices. And we would say here that our achievement levels have picked up with our integration of technology and our open space learning rather than gone down.
See, when I was at school, we never had Google. This thing here would have seemed like a spaceship when I was at school.
Did you guys use chalkboards?
We had chalkboards.
Don't laugh. We did.
It enables our kids to learn, create and share in a way that it's hard to do with pencil and paper. It enables them to learn outside of the hours of schooling. We can now demonstrate that effect. It's taken a while, but we've got solid evidence for individuals who do things in the holidays for their learning that we can track and see, blogging and stuff like that, talking to their friends online, learning online, and their learning goes up, not down.
That's quite amazing, isn't it?
That is very amazing. And we couldn't do it using the old system.
What do you guys want to do when you leave school? What are your thoughts so far about what your dreams are and what you want to do?
I want to be a teacher, doctor.
I
want to be a policeman,
rugby player. I think what's really striking here is you can see that they teach high expectations, and for these kids it's real, they've internalised it. Like, their automatic expectations of themselves are really high.
A magician.
Let me show you the only magic trick that I actually know, right? Let me get a pencil. Their dreams are big dreams, just as big as they should be. Through the magical powers of my amazing mind, I'm going to use the power of my mind to hold the pencil without dropping it. So basically, using the power of my mind, a preconception that a lot of people would have coming into, say, a decile 1A school is that you have a whole heap of behavioural issues. If I don't use the power of my mind, it just drops. None of that did I see out there. And that was because, I think, of the culture that they've built up. And you see kids managing themselves. It's me. I am Dynamo, let's be honest. I think a lot of people choose schools based on decile ranking because they think a higher decile school is going to be a better school. That was a lovely classroom. I looked in that classroom and I'd be happy for any of my kids to be in that classroom. I wish I'd been in that classroom when I'd been a kid.
Primary schools have to meet national standards. But on paper, a school like Point England struggles to measure up despite enormous success.
And the truth is, you're actually getting more progress than a lot of other schools.
So part of what we've got to do is to educate the population so that they understand what success is. Because I think that if we can demonstrate that our kids starting a couple of years behind, by year six, say, because that's our goal, if we could have caught nearly everybody up, because there'll always be people who are a bit different and special, but if we could have caught nearly everybody up by year six, well, what a demonstration of progress that would be. Because that would mean that we are doing roughly 1.5 times more progress than other places, because we're not just travelling at the norm, we're catching up to it. We're going faster. Our kids will work faster and our teachers will work faster and our mums and dads will work hard at it too. If we could demonstrate that, then we should be acknowledged as having outstanding progress.
I'm really frustrated by this. Point England School is all for national standards, just not the narrow way they're banded right now, because they don't adequately reflect the huge strides kids are making here. Instead, they can appear like they're underperforming, and that's a negative for them and their parents. I think we need to rethink how national standards define and measure progress.
Kia ora, my name is Hannah and I'm in room 17. Our school is a full primary with around 600 children from years 1 to 8. Most of our families are Māori.
Those in the know, educators from around the country and overseas, regularly visit to look and learn from Poinhinglin's breakthroughs.
People over the world come, like when the Google Filmers came.
The Google Filmers came?
Yeah, yes. They worked for Google and then they came and made a short movie about us.
Like, documentary.
Google came and made a documentary about your school?
Yes. Yeah.
Google?
Yes.
The Google?
Yes.
Google.co.nz
yes.
Google?
Yes.
Wow. And here's part of that Google film. I'm just amazed I didn't know about it before.
Children who have access to the internet are actually able to manage their own learning. It gives them the opportunity to be the best they can be.
So originally I came to Poinhinglin School to look at what they're doing here to help Māori and Pacifica kids and kids from low decile homes to achieve. But actually I think the big lesson is one that applies to us all, and it's this. These guys, they're not limited by what the world tells them their kids can achieve. They expect their kids to achieve more than that. And guess what? They do.